We're here today to talk about the history of the Diocese of Raleigh. But history, if we just leave it in a book, if we just analyze it as something that's part of a knowledge of things that happen, is not alive. And there's nothing about today and the Holy Spirit being here in this Eucharistic Congress that is about not being alive. It's about being completely alive. I love the way Bishop Parks put it, that we can have the knowledge of God and to serve one another so that we can be fully alive. And so welcome. The Diocese of Raleigh was founded by the act of the Holy See on December the 12th, 1924. December the 12th, that we were placed under the protection of the Immaculate Conception. December the 12th is also a day that it's celebrated differently for most of us now. But 100 years ago in 1924, it wasn't widely known in North Carolina, the significance and specialness of that day. That day is what, everyone? Our Lady of Guadalupe, one of the biggest days in the diocese. I've been so fortunate to be able to be a minister, especially when I was a parishioner at Sacred Heart downtown, and we would have the wonderful all night long adoration of Our Lady. We would take her out and march around the Capitol building with Our Lady. If you do it really late at night, you don't need a permit. It's a wonderful thing, right? And if police aren't sure what to do, because if you just give them the hot chocolate, then you're good. But isn't it a great thing that already the acts of the Holy Spirit involved in the very founding of our diocese, foreshadowing what would come to be serving a people of Latino and Hispanic heritage. And so we have the protection of the Immaculate Conception, but we celebrate the birthday of our diocese on the feast of Our Lady of Guadalupe. And that's a wonderful, wonderful tribute. I want to talk a little bit about being the youngest brother, right, of a family. So my brothers were older than me, 14 years older, 9 years older, 8 years older, and then here I came later in life, a surprise, another almost Immaculate Conception. But in a different way, of course, my mom was surprised but happy. But being the youngest in a family, I automatically knew it was good to know about history. Because, see, brothers forget about their own history. And I noticed my siblings were better to me if I could recall the things that they had done, specifically things they had done that my parents didn't know about. And so I've always known and appreciated this value of history, because knowing our history is what? Is valuable. Because it can what? It can color the way we live the future. And there's something about us being the model of church, is the model of family, always. Having siblings that are older, let's all remember that it's a blessing, even when they're difficult, because being close to one another, all of us, and learning from each other's mistakes and triumphs is a blessing. So knowing each other's history is a double blessing. This way of being the people of the body of Christ, that we talk about history in the context of a Eucharistic Congress. So as a body of Christ, I want to get a real feel about where we're all from. I see we have some people from Fayetteville here, one of my classmates. Chapel Hill is represented. Apex is represented. We have some people from Wilmington. We have any military folks? Any retired military folks? Raise your hand. Okay. Because I want to make sure I include different things for each session about who we are as this body of Christ. Do we have any Lebanese Catholics present? Any Lebanese Catholics? Polish Catholics? A few. All right. We'll talk about some of these different groups. And then how about some Ukrainian Catholics? Oh, very good. And we have the new church in Raleigh for that. So all of us have come to North Carolina in a different way. It's helpful even if we start to know about North Carolina before December 12th, 1924. North Carolina is a rural state, put away from everybody, and it's always been that way because of a real important geographical reason. The coast of North Carolina. is a shallow barrier island, swampy coast. So it did not lend itself well for a seaport. It did not lend itself well across the whole front part of our state to be a place of commerce. So North Carolina developed as one of the 13 original colonies without any major city, without really a major port of commerce. Wilmington, our Wilmington people, was close as we got to something that was a stable port. I'm happy to tell you from my own history, my mother was from Liverpool, England. And Wilmington, if you know your history, when it was founded, was called New Liverpool. Ah. And later they changed the name after the Earl of Warwick. Earl of Wilmington. And something that happens still today in the church when we're looking to build a hall, we'll change the name if you give enough money. Wilmington became Wilmington and not New Liverpool because the Earl of Wilmington in England sent money when they all got sick, when they had the fever. And so he became a patron of the settlers that were in Wilmington. And so they named the place then after him. So there's been a change. There wasn't ever anybody rich in Liverpool, evidently, that helped out. So Wilmington is now that place. If you're here from Wilmington, you still might have a little grudge on your shoulder, right? Because most people in the early Catholicism in the state of North Carolina, Wilmington was the place that some boats would come. There was trade there just a little, and so some Catholics would be there. Everybody thought we would be now in the Diocese of Wilmington, right? They built St. Mary's, the Basilica, with the thought for it to be the cathedral of the new diocese. But that didn't happen that way because of Leo Haig. Leo Haig was the abbey chief in Belmont, the head Benedictine that was in charge of the vicariate of North Carolina. And he was to be the first bishop, but he told the Holy See that he would not leave the abbey. So don't make me bishop, because I'm not leaving Belmont. Do y'all know where Belmont, North Carolina is? Excellent. Beautiful place. I just had a wedding there recently. It's a wonderful place. Leo Haig, running everything, as the Benedictines are apt to still do, said, I will take care of the people in North Carolina that are Catholic. As you might have heard this morning, they thought there might have been, for the whole state of North Carolina at that time, about 300 spread around the state. He said, I don't need to move. I'm not moving to Wilmington. They would send him communiques to move to Wilmington about every other month. Say, we built a beautiful church. St. Mary's, come. It could be the cathedral. And he didn't move. He stayed as the leader of North Carolina Catholicism until he died. And then we first got a bishop and became a diocese back in that 1924. So we're still under this thing of when he passed away, there was a new push throughout America that all these forming new dioceses should be something that's common in our American history. That the seat of government should be central to the people. So the whole thought of having the diocese centered in Wilmington shifted to put it in the middle of the state. We all recall now, Diocese of Raleigh covered the whole state of North Carolina. So by placing the seat of the diocese in Raleigh, it was equal distance for the Catholics throughout the state to be able to travel to gather. Why would they need to gather? Just the priest? Hopefully never just the priest, right? The people of God, the body of Christ, always have the opportunity to gather. This convention today is where? Not in Wilmington. It's in Raleigh, a more central location. Some of my brother priests still question the location this morning. I talked to Father Javier. He came from Pinehurst. They got up at 5 o'clock this morning to get on a bus with their youth groups to come. And he said, why couldn't we have the Congress in Pinehurst? Right? We could all brought our golf clubs and went to Pinehurst. No. So centralized government, this very American way, even now becoming part of our Catholic tradition. So we have the cathedral is at Sacred Heart downtown, which if you've ever been there, was not built as a thought of being a cathedral. It seats 300. 300 people. If you've ever been there, there's a half bathroom. I like telling our young people now, right? Our young people don't even know what a half bathroom is because they grow up in really economic glory nowadays, right? Half bathroom is the sink and just the toilet, nothing else. Sacred Heart has one of them, and you have to go down four steps to the basement for that. And they keep it locked now. There's no bathroom in that place. People said, do we need to build a new cathedral? And I said, just because, yes, we needed bathrooms. You have to build and take care of the people spiritually and their body and their mind as well. And so here we are as a diocese of Raleigh. When did the big split come? What is the big split? So when? Charlotte. And how is our diocese divided? East and west. And it's done evenly. Is there any history behind that? Well, there is. Because the other states, particularly in the South, as growth started to happen, had to split as well. Before the Diocese of Raleigh split in November of 1971, before that, Virginia had split. And Virginia, because they're the Commonwealth state, a different type of people, right, that immigrated and served there, settled there, they split North and South. So you have the Diocese of Arlington and Richmond. They also split in a different kind of way. Prior to the split, they knew it was coming. They knew the population had gathered and been large enough to have two different dioceses. There was, what, a big sea change in the way to minister people after Vatican II. And the bishop of the whole state of Virginia, which was Richmond, said, well, there's congestion about how we should minister to the people, old style, new style, middle style. So we're going to let people start to choose as ministers and priests what they like. And so if you've ever been in both parts of Virginia, Arlington and Richmond, you'll notice a difference in liturgies and in the way ministry is done. All the priests that did not embrace the new changes of Vatican II were able to transfer and move to the northern part of the state. And all the ones that were excited about the changes moved to the southern part. So at their very, when the notice came from the Vatican, creating the new diocese, the people and the sides of the teams they were on were already settled. In North Carolina, Bishop Waters watched that happen. Because what happened after that was now you had all of us Catholics, all of us receiving the same sacraments, all of us under the same Eucharistic, right, body of Christ, acting in different accords. And when you send your young people to college on one side of the line or other, it's in a distress. And so Bishop Waters said, we know that the diocese of Raleigh is not going to be able to take care of the whole state. There's going to be a split. They put the paperwork in and said there's going to be a notice coming from the Vatican that usually takes about 2 years, and I'm not letting anybody choose sides. So where you are is where you're going to be. When the notice came for our new diocese, that was an important day for them, December 12th, 1924, because in November, it's 1971. Where you were serving is where you ended up. I happen to be good friends with Monsignor Mosline. Anybody from the coast, right, know him? He was at St. Egbert's in Morehead City for many, many years. And his brother lives in Charlotte. His brother's family in Charlotte. He came from Baltimore. He wanted to be in Charlotte, but that's not where he was in November 1971. So he did his whole priesthood in the Diocese of Raleigh, the eastern half. And they tried to keep everything mixed in a way that we weren't in any tangent. What's happened since then? Living history. You have different bishops and different ways of doing things. So is now Charlotte more conservative? It is. But what does that mean? Everybody's still pretty close. We're still the body of Christ. and we're still working together. I think Bishop Waters did a good thing by letting everybody be where they were going to be and let the Holy Spirit work it out. But that's part of living history and knowing why. Our state still grew in a slow way because we didn't have an economic strength. But what happened? Well, some big things happened. In the 50s, we mentioned earlier, Lebanese Catholics started showing up because of the unrest there and the open immigration that was available for them to be able to sponsor themselves and come. The Diocese of Raleigh would not be as vibrant as it is today without the support and help of our Lebanese Catholics. If you ever hear the names Ferris, Zaytoun, Khoury, all of those are great American Catholics from the Lebanese side of the church who helped us as Roman Catholics. When they immigrated here, there was not the Maronite churches available for them to go to, just much as like the Ukraine church were happy to have that now for the people to go to. But they didn't have that, so they joined our churches and supported them well. There was a Zaytoun that they did very well. They're from New Bern. Any New Bern people here? A lot of the Zaytouns now have moved to Raleigh to be spread out in. There are a lot of orthodontists and dentists and lawyers. But the first one, he was a beer distributor. He was a prayerful holy beer distributor. He often did things with all the money coming in to help the church and help build new churches. He did something one time, though, that I'll highlight to you about how things change and how in a smaller church people listen. He had the opportunity to buy some businesses that were changing in New Bern, and one of them was a newsstand. There's a historic change already that we've witnessed in our lifetime. Remember when everybody got the newspaper and read that? And then you could go to a newsstand and buy the newspaper or newspapers from other areas. Well, the Zaytouns bought as one of their businesses this newsstand that was in New Bern. And as even as the 80s came, newsstands went out of business except for one really profitable thing in newsstands. And those are magazines that you shouldn't be selling. But it's the very profitable part. Well, Bishop Waters said, who owns that newsstand? And he said, oh, that's a good Catholic family from St. Paul's. Bishop Waters got in his car, left Raleigh, and drove to New Bern and had a meeting with the Zaytouns. They still love telling me about all the money they lost by selling the newsstand. But isn't that great? Shouldn't we be courageous as pastors and ministers and bishops today to call each other out when our businesses and our want for money don't align with our true beliefs? And I always look at that family. They sold it right away. It wasn't the main part of their business line. They sold it right away, and they told all their children and their friends that story. Because what? Because we need to hear stories like that. That's the wonderful thing about history, is that we're not just somebody who walks through it. We're part of it. And being part of history in the church means what? That we've received the love of God. We've been transformed to conform our life to Christ, and we're passing that on to each other, and especially to the people that God placed in our life to take care of, our family and friends. You heard earlier that Bishop Zarama is the sixth bishop of Raleigh, and that we've had long-serving bishops. Let me run through some of the bishops for you. Our first bishop was William Haffey. He was here for 12 years. He was a priest from Baltimore before becoming a bishop. His 12 years here, when there was 300-some Catholics, he spent most of his time going up north, begging for money, so that they could have money to what? To go find some more priests, right? So you need a central office, which doesn't tell you too much, but then you need to go and find priests and pay for their education. He went around fundraising. He was here 12 years, and then he became the bishop of Scranton, Pennsylvania. Any Pennsylvania Catholics here? Right. A lot of Pennsylvania priests from that area came because of Bishop Haffey. After Bishop Haffey, 1938, we had Eugene McGinnis. He doesn't sound Latino, does he? An Irishman. He was trained in Philadelphia. And he had worked with the Catholic Extension Society. Have anybody heard about the Catholic Extension Society? Right. Their main offices are in Chicago. From the propagation of faith. So if you're from Boston, you hear about the St. James Society. But this Catholic Extension Society, I knew as a little kid in the military because our calendars always came from them. It was a way that they made money selling parish calendars all across the world to make money for what? To build churches in rural, non-Catholic areas. This Diocese of Raleigh, for most of its 100 years, has been a mission territory. And Bishop Zarama, his size shoe is an 8, keeps telling us priests that we are still a mission territory. He lets us know that that hasn't changed. Okay, so for Catholic Extension Society, you had to be under 3% Catholic. If you were under 3% Catholic, they would give you grants, matching grants to build churches. Most of the churches you visit and attend in North Carolina were a recipient of a Catholic Extension Society grant for us to be able to build a church in a non-Catholic area with not enough Catholics, but from the help of Catholics throughout America who wanted what? The Eucharist brought to every part of America. They wanted what? They wanted our families to be able to be baptized, receive First Communion, go to reconciliation, and be confirmed. Anytime I'm immersed in the history of our early bishops and I see their zeal for going out to these small towns and starting masses in houses and building these little tiny churches, this would be a big church for most of any of the buildings they did. Why did they work so hard for small sets of people? As soon as you think of any family that would come to the church and say, we live in Tarboro. How do we baptize our child? See, those questions make priests and bishops work hard. We live in Swansboro. How is my child going to be confirmed? Who's going to teach them? So when you live in a rural area and it's been placed there by God, you still need what? You need the fullness of the church. And there's no simple way to form our kids in faith. Nikki works in that every day. And it takes what? It takes an army of people to wrap around our young people and families to give them that. So this great desire to be able to receive the needs of the people of sacraments was met with people with great hearts to work hard for them. And then to go find priests to bring them here, to recruit religious orders to bring them here, to serve small groups of people, but also to let people who wanted to help, help. So we are in great gratitude to Philadelphia, Baltimore, Boston, Chicago, Atlanta, for sending money all over the years, Cleveland, as people of the Catholic Extension Society so that we could build a foundation of Catholicism here. That's an amazing thing. One of the saddest days that Monsignor Lewis, a great friend of mine, says is when they got the letter, and it was in the 90s, that the diocese no longer qualified for Catholic Extension Society grants. He said, quick, who put those statistics together? But we know we're over. So we're 5% of the population now. We're 8% in the metropolitan area of Charlotte and Raleigh. So a little bump for the high populated areas, but still mission territory. So that footprint from the bishop that I receive every day reminds us that all of us are evangelizers. All of us have to continue to say, how are we going to serve our families and raise them in the faith in this rural state, in this state that's mixed of people, and still we're a minority. I really feel for parents, because your child going through life here in North Carolina is going to have a 5% chance of falling in love with another Catholic, right? A lot of them convert. My dad converted. My grandfather made sure of that. But to keep our faith, to give what we love, to the people we love, right, is a challenge. And it really flavors that history of who we are now in this minority. Also challenges what? It changes the way we do church. I was talking with Dr. Espina, who's down the hallway, taught us at Boston College and came over and taught at our seminary. And the way church is done in the South is different than the Catholic population metropolitan area of Boston. They're 46% Catholic. That's a different way of having to explain and preach than being in North Carolina. Which means what? Which means something that's been highlighted, I hope, all day, is we have to be open and inviting. All of our families, every family that comes to church is mixed. They're not 100% Catholic. So our faith is what? Not just interior, but it's on display. There's something that happened so special today when we were out in the big lobby. My business life, I've had an office in Raleigh since 1996, and I've been to this convention center many times for business functions, for city functions, for political functions. This is the first time ever in my life, in 57 years, that I've been in this convention center where it's us. We filled this place up with Catholics in North Carolina. That's amazing. We never thought that would happen growing up anywhere near here. And now what? And we're not here because it's a trade show or a political rally. We're here because of Christ and this body of Christ and the beautiful sacraments that our church has. So that we're now even more fortified to be quiet evangelizers of our families, to be able to share and draw them into the faith so that they can have this same gift of God. Back to our bishops. After Bishop McGinnis, he was here 6 years, and then he left and was named the bishop of Oklahoma City, Tulsa. So you can see when you're a small diocese, you're kind of like a training ground for bishops then to go on to a bigger diocese. That's when we got Vincent Waters, 1945, a kind of a big year, right? The end of World War II. He would be able to stay with us 29 years. So when you look at the influential people of our diocese for the first 100 years, that's really Bishop Haffey the first kind of set the tone of us being missionaries, of us relying on the help of people outside the diocese, and of us going courageously and hard on recruiting priests to come here. And then you have Bishop Waters, 29 years, who follows him in 1945. Bishop Waters has a mixed history and a mixed way of, depending on who you ask, on whether they liked him or not. That's the great thing about being here, because y'all aren't going to tell anybody what I said about him, right? I was checking with Monsignor Lewis. I said, does Bishop Waters have any family still living around here? And they said, no. I'm really so blessed. Every Tuesday I have dinner with the senior Monsignors. So that's Monsignor Wall, Monsignor Lewis, and Monsignor Steib. So those three, and then they allow me to cook and clean around them and eat. But also, they've all been priests. They were from the class of 1961. So they were all brought into their priesthood and ordained by Bishop Waters. And they have let me know about him. The good, the bad, and the ugly. But a lot of good. What I want all of our people to know and for us to carry home to our young people, because these issues that they're in with culture every day are important for us to be able to feed back to them of what the church believes. And the big issue about Bishop Waters that we should be sharing with our young people is he was a forerunner of civil rights in America, and particularly in the South. As bishop of the Diocese of Raleigh, still covering the whole state of then, he mandated that all the parishes and schools be integrated. And he mandated that in 1953. That was a courageous, hard statement. If you check your thing, that was before Boston, Baltimore. He mandated that there not be separate places for worship and school for Catholics throughout the diocese. So that's a year before Brown versus Board of Education, the Supreme Court case who said everybody needed to look at that. That was a big step, and he got a lot of pushback for it. And we're still picking up the pieces of what happened from that. Because what did integration bring us? Well, it brought us together, but also we lost some people. We lost people on both sides of that. We lost our African-American Catholics, and we lost some Anglo-Catholics. And that's a sad reality of bringing people together. But Bishop Waters did not deter from it and push forward in it. If anybody here from Our Lady of Guadalupe in Newton Grove, he went there because there was a refusal to integrate. And he went there and it wasn't safe. And people were ready to string him up. And he stood fast with the Spirit, proclaimed who he was and what he was doing. And the people didn't harm him. They still hated each other, but they didn't harm him. That parish is still on a rebuild from all of the discord from that. And we have been part of that history. The first organization in the whole state of North Carolina to see before the Supreme Court saw that racial prejudice didn't have a place with people who profess their belief in Christ Jesus. And if we share that with our young people, to give them that proudness of who Catholics can be, we will gain hearts. Because what they hear, right, in the political conversations of the world is people who are of religious values, right, are closed-minded, not bringing people together, but splintering people. They hear that religious people are racist, and that's not true. And so we have to be stewards of that. So Bishop Waters had a great legacy for that. What's some of his changing legacies that the priests are still upset about? Well, when he was a young new bishop, he got all the priests together in priest councils and created like what you see now today, kind of a way of listening to the people before you make decisions. The synodal process of let's just listen to the people and make decisions. Well, Bishop Waters started that. There was a priest council, and they had a lot of sway. And as he got older in the job, like most of us, he started listening less. So he got rid of the council. And I'm here to tell him he's passed away, but his people are still mad at him for that. He was a great bishop, a missionary heart. He went all over the state and bought property where property shouldn't have been bought by people who told him, but are now parishes. He also went all over the United States to recruit seminarians who weren't being accepted by dioceses who were too full of priests and brought them to North Carolina. And we're all still benefits of that. And he accepted priests who were being turned down. It's amazing to see now because we have such a shortage of priests. Say, I'm a proof of that. There's such a shortage of priests. They're really loose on taking us now, right? But in his time, that wasn't the case. There was cutoffs. So if you had any type of disability, you would be removed from formation for most of the major dioceses. Bishop Waters would go find out the personal story of them and say, can they still minister? I don't care if they've got cerebral palsy on one hand. I don't care if they have a lisp. Are they people of God? And he was true to that and brought people to the diocese. We still have our priest retreats every year. And when I talk with the old priest, our retired priest, we're one of the few dioceses in the country that invite all the retired priests to the priest retreat every year. And that's thanks to all your donations, by the way. We pay for them to come. But we get to hear, they always felt like they landed in North Carolina because they were rejected somewhere else, that they were this misfits. But because they were misfits and had been welcomed and loved by a bishop and a people, it conformed their heart to Christ so that they could what? Really work hard to serve. That because of their disabilities and what had tossed them out of formation in other places, to be able to come even to rural backwoods North Carolina was now such a blessing that they would serve harder. And so we're all benefits of that. And then when we work and pray with the seminarians, let them know we're not looking for perfection in appearance, in mobility, right? That they can't have some quirks. No, just connection to God. And we always should be that missionary heart of bring people here, because I'll tell you this, we still need more priests. The other part Bishop Waters did get in trouble with was the nuns. So Bishop Haffey and McGinnis had invited a bunch of religious communities to come to North Carolina to serve the people, specifically to serve the black people, to serve the Latinos that were coming for migrant workers, and to serve the sick. Anybody here from Southern Pines, Pinehurst? Aha, so the sisters came there. And because of some rich Yankees, right? I can say Yankee, I'm a Southerner, but some rich Northerners from Connecticut had a place because of Pinehurst and gave them an estate. And they wanted the sisters to help look after them as they got old. So our big first Catholic hospital is down there. It's now morphed into St. Joseph of the Pines. All the sisters did that. In Raleigh, we had St. Agnes Hospital. The sisters did that. That was for the African-American community. It's right by St. Augustine College. The sisters came. The sisters were all around helping in rural places. When there was this change, Bishop Waters said, "Why aren't the sisters wearing a habit?" Well, the sisters had changed their own conferences and rules, right? Voted for different things in the 60s. Bishop Waters didn't like that. He put out an edict. If you're not wearing a habit, get out. He did put out a letter that the sisters that wouldn't wear a habit, it put some of the sisters in a bad situation because their order had changed their habit into some of the dresses where most of us grew up watching. You know, it had the gray and the blue, you knew they were a sister, but it wasn't a habit. It was just like uniform dress. They either drove the bus or were a sister, had the uniform look, right? But they had to wear what their superior told them to wear, but the Bishop Waters didn't want to hear it. So we lost some sisters. They packed up and moved back under his leadership. That didn't feel good. He grew out of that, and the ones that said, and just stood firm, we're still here. You know, when he died, he had a heart attack. He had a heart attack at the rectory at Sacred Heart downtown. And he had it 2 days before the 50th anniversary of our diocese. So before they were doing the celebration, which was going to be at Dorton Arena, that was new, right? Y'all know that place. Guess who the speaker was for the 50th anniversary of the diocese? Bishop Fulton Sheen. Bishop Fulton Sheen comes to North Carolina to speak at the 50th anniversary. Bishop Waters greets him, puts him in his hotel, and he comes back and has a heart attack and dies. Bishop Fulton Sheen still gave his speech, but it was kind of a somber occasion. He died, and they had the celebration and then the funeral the next day. That's sad. Then we arrived with a new bishop, this bishop being from Baltimore, Bishop Joseph Gosman. Many of you may have known him. I was fortunate enough to get to know him and be part of his circle for a little while, looking after him, especially in his later years. He was not a big fan of priest becoming priest older in life, and so he would lay in his bed as later, and I would tell him I'm progress, and he would give me a look that I'm still not sure what it meant to this day. But I know he was praying for me. He was here, let me check, he was here a long service And he really shaped to what we have as far as the geographics of our diocese today. 31 years he was our bishop, and that's when the Hispanics arrived in bigger ways. Why do we have the big influx of Latinos? Agriculture was one of them. And then something started happening that many of you may have experienced, hurricanes. Right? So every time the state gets hit with hurricanes, it creates a lot of construction work. And so people come for that construction work. Most of the companies that came for our original hurricanes all came up from Florida, bringing with them Latino populations. Most times hurricanes do lots of damage. It usually takes a year to a year and a half to reconstruct everything. Guess what happens in a year and year and a half when you're young and working? You fall in love and start a family. And now you need to find a place to go to church and baptize your children and have them learn their lessons about First Communion and First Reconciliation. And so what happens? Our diocese is growing in this Hispanic population. The other thing that happened for especially our South American people is North Carolina has continued to be a place of lower cost, higher education. Our universities of NC State, UNC, Wake Forest, all of those places have attracted people from out the world to come. And so we have a lot of our Peruvians, Ecuadorians, Colombians who have come to what? Come to be part of this education system. And when they land and become part of the fabric of life, they need a church. Has anybody here ever been to the hospital and had a Filipino nurse or doctor? So I want to be on the record as a priest who loves all people from the Philippines. Some Filipinos here. All the priests in this diocese, we are so thankful. So when the Philippines, a poor, poor place after World War II, reached out to America for help for the poverty, the Americans, we do things in a capitalistic way. We came up with a way for them to come and immigrate to America through the federal government. And we said, if they are certified teachers or nurses, then they can come because we need teachers and nurses. And so a great number came to North Carolina, and we're so thankful. And they're still here. And many of them still have passed on this love of serving others as teachers and as people in the medical profession. Anytime we have the big Santo Niño Mass, I feel so comfortable. I say, if anybody faints, there's like 80 doctors here. Everybody will be taken care of. There's something I want to share with you about the Filipinos that have been throughout the diocese now since the 50s, coming under those real requirements of immigrations. Remember, the church is about always respecting government, which makes us what? Legal immigrants. That's part of us. So they've come and been a part, but they bring with them this tradition from the Philippines. In a Filipino family at home, when they cook a family meal, they save a plate for the priest. And that still happens every week at St. Mary Magdalene, my church. So they are always bringing food to the priest. So I recommend that to our Italian people and Irish people. It's a great tradition. Just a plate, just one plate is a good thing. Bishop Gosman was one who was very humble and shy as a person. He was an introvert. So he would stand back and let others lead as long as they were leading in the right way. And so this is when it comes up to something I want to bring out because it's important. It's important for all of us to know and to talk about. Sexual abuse in the church has been a sin and a cause of pain for too many people. And we're all need to be steadfast and work for the safety of our loved ones and families now and forever. And anyone who hasn't reached out to the church to cope with pain, please call us. Please let me know. Please know that I feel complete remorse for the pain the church has caused in abuse. And we need to take it upon ourselves to do what we can to make people whole again and to always work together so that doesn't happen. I bring this up when we talk about the history of Bishop Gossman, because under Bishop Gossman, he was a forerunner of responding to allegations of abuse. We have a great history in our diocese, which has kept us out of bankruptcy proceedings and any of that stuff that other dioceses are going through and all the hurt, because he always, with employees, if you were not being ministers of God, he removed you and took you out. He also, I don't know if it's right or wrong, he did not believe that sending anybody to a therapy unit for 2 weeks changed them enough to be left alone in charge of the people of God. And so we had abuse. Most of it was from itinerant religious that came through the area. But all of us should know the history of our church and of our particular Diocese of Raleigh. We owe a debt of gratitude to Bishop Gossman, who always responded in a removal way of anybody who was not playing right. And so God bless him for that. A lot of my priest friends that I went to seminary with throughout the country suffer to this day because of the pain their communities are still in because of the abuse. We were spared from a great number of that. That doesn't mean it did not exist. So anybody who was with anybody, let us know. The published list was done through the work of Bishop Burbage after Bishop Gossman. And one of the first things that Bishop Luis did his first year here was to publish the list. There's 29 credible accused priests in the diocese. That list is on our website, the Diocese of Raleigh. I invite you to look and make sure if you have any family or friends that was there to check on them. All right? But we need to be always open and clear about those things. We have had good stewardship of late. And as somebody who comes from the business world, the corporate world, and from a large family, I watch it, and I hope you keep us all watching it. So we're thankful to Bishop Gossman and his work in that. The other thing I can tell you about Bishop Gossman from knowing him and hanging out with him is he was really super humble. And I didn't know growing up, I thought bishops were on a different playing field, but he was not that way. And he brought, I think, because of us being Catholics in the South and not many of us, that we need to be family. And he was that way. His favorite thing to do, because he was an introvert, was after a parish function where the bishop always come and they have to talk to everybody, he was scared of that. So he would take a camera and take pictures of people. That was easier than talking to everybody about everything. He would say, okay, you stand, I'll take your picture. Get your friend together, I'll take your picture. And people loved it. The bishop's taking our picture. And he would work the room in that way, taking the picture of everybody. When he passed away, I was in charge of cleaning out his things, and people started calling to me about, what are you going to do with all the pictures? And is there a box of pictures? I said, there's a box of pictures, but there's not many, because there was no film in that camera. But everybody felt great, and Bishop took my picture, and so there you go. He did film it sometimes, but not very often. But when we cleaned out his closet at his house after he'd been bishop for 32 years, there were some things that really touched me about him, and I want to share one with them because I think you'll know him a little too. I found a cardboard tube in the closet, and I unrolled it. And it was his PhD certificate from Catholic University, his second PhD. He had never opened it. It was in the closet. That was not important to him. Important to him was serving God's people and being with the people. That's a great model, and I try to keep myself a little bit like that, that we don't flate ourselves up. He didn't hang things on the wall about him ever. When he died, and now that his house is called the Gossman House, retired priests live there, we had to put his picture and his stuff up after he had passed. He never put anything up about himself. That's a great tribute. After he passed, our next bishop was Bishop Michael Burbage. Everybody know him? Good guy, right? He's now the Bishop of Arlington. He was our bishop for 10 years. He was a great man. He is still serving right now at the USCCB as the chairman of the pro-life committee. Bishop Burbidge is someone who is a hard-working bishop and priest. Before he was the chairman of the pro-life committee for the USCCB throughout the country, he was the communications chairman. Before he did that, he was the vocations chairman. He is hard-working, and he has an amazing memory. If he was here, he would go around the room and remember each one of you. When I see him, he asks me about my dad and my brothers, and he knows them all. It's amazing. A gift from God comes through just regular people. He is somebody who worked hard. He also transformed us from this real quiet, shy Bishop Gossman to someone who was more organized into the way church needs to grow. Because now, when he got here, we went to 200,000 Catholics. So we needed what? Well, the Catholic office was in an old elementary school, right? So he changed that. We got a new Catholic center. We added staff, more structure. And he took on a project that Bishop Gossman kept putting off. And he used to really get us tweaked up, Bishop Gossman, because we were ready to build a new cathedral. Remember, Sacred Heart set 300 people. And we said, we need a bigger one. We're coming out of the seams. That's the next bishop, he would tell us. The next guy can build it. He kept putting money in the bank for it, which is good. So Bishop Burbidge got here, and he said, yes, we're going to build a new cathedral. And we said, yes. Where? Because a lot of us wanted it downtown. Well, where was going to be another question, because there was a place called Nazareth. And back in our history was an orphanage there. And it was a place bought by Father Thomas Price, the first North Carolina-born Catholic priest ordained from here. And so he bought it without permission, by the way. The farm where the cathedral sits, 427 acres, he bought it without permission, which is, priests, we can't do that. Like, until you, like your parish council, you can't buy property without, Rome has to decide if you can do it or not. He bought it anyway and got in big trouble. In archives, there's these letters to Father Price telling him to stop buying property and without permission and to sell it. And so we wouldn't even have that place if he'd asked for permission. So it's kind of nice. Our cathedral is put on a place that was in trouble about the very beginning. So it's a good thing. Bishop Burbidge also did something really, really good. He rejuvenated our vocations efforts in the diocese. Vocations was always important to him. He was a former rector in Philadelphia of St. Charles Borromeo Seminary. He reached out and took in people kind of like Bishop Waters, who might have been too old, who might have had some other challenges in life or history. My brother priest. And he allowed us to, form ourselves in Christ, encouraged us. And he was a great bishop for that. All the seminarians under his watch, every month, had to send him a letter with four paragraphs on the four pillars of formation. And he responded like that. So he really touched us. A lot of the priests that we now have in the diocese came from him and his real support. So we all love him and really support him. Every time I've gotten a new assignment at my desk, when I get there, there'll be a letter from him. So he has some spies somewhere. He said, well, congratulations on your assignment to St. Mary Magdalene. I was like, I just got here. Wow. Love Bishop Burbidge. So we love him. Bishop Luis succeeded him as our sixth bishop. And he came here with the Episcopal motto, God is love. And if you spend any time with him, all of his homilies and speaking with us always returns to love. And he does something that I want you to know will be in his history. He keeps telling us we are in the best diocese in the world. Because why? Because Christ is present to us, available to us, and that we're to take that to heart. And he wants us to take it always back to our parishes and says, if your parish isn't the best parish in the world, why? And make it so. And that's a great challenge. I asked him one day, I said, how long are you going to keep saying that we're the best diocese in the world? He said, until everybody realizes it and knows it in their heart. Isn't that a great answer? He is from originally Colombia. He's a Colombiano. Did all his college and formation in America. It came to us as a priest of the Diocese of Atlanta, where he was auxiliary bishop and vicar general for 9 years under Cardinal Gregory, Wilton Gregory. And that's who our province is tied to, Atlanta. All the Southern Catholics are together in the province of Atlanta. So that's Georgia, South Carolina, and North Carolina. Let me check our notes as we're starting to get to our time. That's good, that's good. So some big changes in the way parishes grew here, just so that we all know. Usually, if some one person became Catholic who was influential, like Dr. Monk in Newton Grove, then he could support and build a parish. Other ways that it happened was things happened throughout this diocese that finally brought some Catholics here. One of them was our military bases. Yay! The military has always traditionally been 20% Catholic. We think it has something to do with that service heart, right? The same way with medical care. People who are in medical care are always higher percentage than the population Catholic. We hope it's because of that service heart. So as the university systems at UNC grew, the number of Catholics grew. And military brought Catholics here, which created what? Our need for growth. Chapel Hill didn't have hardly any Catholics until the World War II. And the Navy made it a flight school. And at the flight school, 40% of those in flight school were Catholic from around the country who said, "Where do we go to Mass?" And they're like, "Uh-oh, we have a problem. There's no church here." So that grew out of that. So you military families, you're part of our history of growing the diocese. And then something else happened. Some legislators in Raleigh got together and built the Research Triangle Park. And a company with three little letters came, and a lot of them were Catholic, and we built a lot of parishes because of IBM. And that's the truth. Three schools were built in the same year, St. Raphael's, St. Francis, St. Mary Magdalene. All of that coming from the new employees and imported Catholics from Research Triangle Park. So if you're part of that history, thank you as well. And that continues. And I know in our parish and here close to Raleigh, because of the work of others are able to come here and they're bringing the Catholics with them. There's something behind me that has a prayer about it. It talks about our centennial. Today has been a great day. We started with the morning prayer, the Mass. It will be fabulous this evening. This starts out 1 year of celebrations today until 2024. There'll be a closing Mass at the cathedral. Cardinal Wilton Gregory will be the principal celebrant for that. Throughout the year, the monstrance that you saw this morning that came in, that's going to visit every deanery. It's going to be available to all the parishes. It's going to take a victory lap around the state of North Carolina for our centennial year. Bishop Zarama wants it to go out to the people, to the homes, to the trailer parks, to the hospitals, to the town squares. The same people, if we just did it at church, the same people would just keep coming. Jesus wants to see everybody. And we are people who came to North Carolina, what? To be nourished by our faith. The faith is here. The church is here. And it's now time for what? To share that faith with everyone. And so we're going to say the centennial prayer together. I hope when the traveling monstrant comes to your parish and anywhere near you, that you'll participate in those activities, that you'll really take the opportunity to learn more about your own parish during the centennial year, to know your history, your family story. It's something that we're all part of. The church is not perfect, but it won't be better unless we're all in it. And if we can share that in the love of Christ, stay close to the Eucharist in our sacraments. The next 100 years will be amazing. So let's all stand and pray. We've been sitting long enough. And if you can see this, that'll be good. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, with humility and unbridled gratitude, we come to you, one faith, one body, on the occasion of the centennial anniversary
the Diocese of Raleigh. It is only through your divine grace, love, and mercy that we have realized unimagined growth. Open our hearts to love as we welcome all those in search of the body of Christ. We ask this in the holy name of Jesus. Amen.
In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Yay.
Thank you. Thank you. Hope you all have a great, great day.